Hi, I'm Kurt Ballou from Converge and God City Studio, and here are 13 albums I've been involved with that are milestones to me. Let's start in no particular order with Cavin, Until Your Heart Stops. These guys were good friends of mine and at the time neighbors of mine. I was working in a little tiny basement studio in Alston, Mass on a 1-inch 24-track tape machine, and it was really the first time I recorded an album that I think really got out there. The first time I felt like people really took notice of me and what I did. I mean, it was really what the band did, but I was kind of along for the ride. And it's one of the records, or one of the most important records, that sort of set my career as a recording engineer in motion. American Nightmare, The Sun Isn't Getting Any Brighter. It was the second EP I did with those guys, the only one that I mixed. And man, when American Nightmare came along, they just put like the whole like world of fast hardcore on its head. I mean, that scene had largely been dominated by kind of youth crew derived bands at the time, and they were just becoming like, it was just so predictable, and AN came along and really like tipped that thing on its head, and it really completely reinvigorated the hardcore scene. And I feel fortunate that I was able to play a role in that. Page 99, document number 8. For those of you who don't know Page 99, they were just a force to be reckoned with. There's a million people on stage. They had, you know, usually 3 guitars, 2 basses, 2 singers, a drummer, you know, who knows what else was going on. And it was this just huge sound that enveloped you. We became great friends during that recording session and have remained friends for many, many years. And some of the members of Page 99 went on to form the band Pygmy Lush, who are also a band I've been really fortunate to work with over the years. Pygmy Lush, Bitter River. Bitter River was an extremely dynamic record to make, which was really challenging to have a record that included both loud and soft songs, things that were recorded on tape, things that were recorded in Pro Tools. It was mixed in all different ways. You know, I played saxophone on the record and helped arrange some songs, and you know, things that were just a guitar and a voice that were flushed out into like a full band arrangement. So that was like super fun, and one of the first times I got to be involved in a record that represented my personal musical taste at the time. You know, I guess I'm most known for like metal and hardcore kind of stuff, but it's not the only thing I listened to. So it was really great to work on a different style of music that I was really excited about, and also with people that I care deeply about, who I feel like have, you know, a lot of integrity as artists and are making really amazing and timeless music. So really happy I was involved in the Pygmy Lush Bitter River record. Torch, Meanderthal. Torch is a band I've been a fan of since its inception. I remember actually during the remixing of Page 99's document number 8, Andy Lowe, who runs Robotic Empire, was here, and he played Torch for me, and I got to hear Torch for the first time, and I was like, oh my god. Like, I was familiar with Floor and some of the guys who, other people from Floor were in this band called Cavity that Converge had toured with. So I knew their stuff, but like the way that Torch put all that stuff together was really phenomenal. And I don't think anybody before them or anybody since them has really like nailed that type of sound. I mean, they're just an incredibly unique band and gifted people. And Meanderthal, I think, is, that's one of the, I don't listen to a lot of stuff I record often, but Meanderthal is still a record that I really enjoy listening to every time I put it on, because I think those are just fantastic songs, and I'm really happy with how it turned out. Young Widows, Old Wounds. That was an incredibly risky, incredibly challenging, yet ultimately an incredibly rewarding recording experience. You know, we recorded a lot of that on the road. It was a mix of like 4 different live shows. We did some stuff in Jason Gagowski's basement in Indiana. He's the drummer for Sweet Cobra and Suicide Note. We did some recording here for it and somehow managed to put it all together into this cohesive work. And I'm super proud of that. And I think that it's a record that really resonated with a lot of people. And it's, you know, it's nice for me to work with people that are coming kind of from the same background as me. You know, like, I know that I do a lot of metal and hardcore kind of stuff, but I think that, you know, my foundation as a musician and as a recordist come more from, like, you know, the DC hardcore kind of world and Gravity Records, Trouble Man Records, you know, that kind of stuff. And the Young Widows guys, even with their previous band, Breathe or Resist, that I had also recorded once, you know, they share a lot of the same kind of musical lineage that I do. So working with them was really nice because we kind of had a great focus and I think shared understanding of what the direction of the band was. Beast Milk, Climax. I love that record. That's a band that just wrote incredible and timeless songs and pulled together some styles of music that I love that I've never heard anybody else really successfully do. And I love that record doesn't sound like any other record that I have done. And there's a lot of reasons for that. Some me, some them. Some having to do with a bit of a language barrier with them being Finnish and me not quite understanding them. It made for a very interesting recording process. And the end result of the record is something that sounds like nothing else I've done. But it's also great for me to do things like that and prove to myself that I can do more than just, you know, making really loud metallic hardcore records. Disfear's Live the Storm. Disfear is a band made up of several legends of Swedish death metal. Swedish death metal is the stuff that I think resonated most with me, and, you know, particularly Entombed and At the Gates. And Disfear has a member of Entombed and a member of At the Gates in it. So having a chance to work with some people who were musical heroes of mine was really phenomenal. To have them, you know, people that I look up to, that I want to teach me how to do things, to have them entrust their music with me was super, super flattering. And it's funny, I hoped that I would learn a lot from Thomas and Uffe on that record. I didn't learn what I expected to learn. I expected, like, Uffe to come in here and show me how to get a badass, like, HM2 guitar tone. But he didn't. He just came in and was like, yeah, here's a pedal, and he just played like one of my amps and one of my guitars and was like, here, go get me a guitar sound, and yeah, that sounds good. And he didn't spend a lot of time like dialing in a tone. He just let me do that, which was strange. I was like, dude, you're the master. Like, I want to learn, you know? And it was, I guess, but so what I did learn from him was more just, you know, trust your ears, trust your instincts. It's how you play your instrument that really makes the difference. And the reason why those guys made records that sounded like they did was not because they like belabored the tone. They just were badass players with badass songs, and they went in and banged it out, and it became an iconic kind of sound after the fact. You know, it wasn't like they had a real specific idea or record that they were worshiping that they were trying to get to, like, you know, like I was in my early experimentation with that type of sound. Seance Prime by Trap Them. I've had a very long relationship with Brian and Ryan of Trap Them. I've recorded most of their material, and I also, the very first recording ever in this space at God City in Salem was a band that they were in previously called Backstabbers Incorporated. That band maybe most exemplifies the sort of American take on Swedish death metal. At least they were one of the originators of it. And certainly have done it better than just about any other band out there. And it's become, you know, one of the things that I'm known for, I suppose, but also just any time that a band, you know, become true friends of mine and have such a long-standing relationship with me, it always is really super important to me. And I really remember that experience of getting to know those guys deeply, really fondly. And, you know, just did a new record with them last month, and it's fucking awesome, so check it out. Nails, Abandon All Life. I can't tell you how many times people have commented to me about the sound of that record, particularly the guitar sound. It's like one of the grossest, most antisocial, furious guitar tones I've ever got in like the entirety of my recording career. And it's like, I can't think of a guitar tone that better matches Todd Jones than Abandon All Life. Don't have much else to say about that one. It's just one of those like lightning in a bottle kind of records. I know that will be remembered. I'll certainly remember it for a long time. Code Orange, I Am King. Code Orange are a really interesting band. I first met them at a small festival in Philadelphia when they were playing. They were, you know, maybe 15, 16 years old or something, and they were opening up for my band. And they were already fantastic players and had their shit together and come to find out had already been playing together for years. I've recorded two albums with them, I Am King, the second one. Have another one coming up soon too, but hardcore's changing, and much like American Nightmare did in the early 2000s, I think Code Orange is doing now. They are approaching it with knowledge of a lot of different styles of hardcore from the 90s, as well as, you know, other types of metal. It's just a whole different perspective than what people from my generation used as the vernacular that they wrote songs. And Code Orange are writing with a new vernacular, and it's really interesting and exciting to see it and to be a part of it. And knowing that I don't have the perspective to write that style of music myself, it's cool to observe it as a participant but not a writer. High on Fire, De Vermis Mysteris. This is my first time working with High on Fire. I've since done another record with them, but High on Fire is, you know, that's just it's a freight train. There's no getting around that. They're one of the most powerful live bands I've ever seen. I've been a fan of them since their inception. Converge had played with them, you know, back when they were touring on their first EP, and they've always been this band that I've looked up to. And again, sort of like Disfear, having a chance to record people that have been really influential on me, whose music I have respected and admired for a long time. And, you know, I used to put on the first like three albums as references when I was mixing all the time, because I just like worshipped how those records sounded. And then all of a sudden, like, I had to, you know, I had to work with the band, and I had to do something that wouldn't fall short of those expectations that, you know, were set forth in their first three albums. So it was really high stress for me trying to make those records sound as great as those first three records do. Really honored that the band chose me and then chose to come back to me one more time. So just, you know, fantastic record. I listen to it all the time. I like, when I play guitar, I like sound check with some of those riffs, and Matt just has this crazy awesome guitar style that I have been really influenced by, even though I don't sound like him, and nobody ever will. I think the biggest milestone record for me in my career has been Converge, Jane Doe. Sometimes I'm miscredited as having recorded that record. I didn't. Matt Eller did most of the recording. I did some of it, but Matt did most of the recording and the mixing. I suppose I functioned as the producer, but it's the record that certainly launched the second phase of Converge's career. You know, we became much, much more active at that point, and I think due in part to what was happening with just the underground music scene at the time, but also due in part to the success of that record. And because of Jane Doe, I think I met a lot of people that I otherwise wouldn't have met, both in the U.S. and in Europe, you know, friends, bands, you know, promoters, so forth and so on. And all of that was kind of the beginning of me really finding a way to network and turn my recording hobby into a career. If it wasn't for Jane Doe, I don't think that I would have a career in recording today, because I don't think that people would have known to contact me to record their bands. So I am very thankful for, you know, my bandmates and for Matt Ellard and everybody who worked to make Jane Doe what it was. There you have it, 13 milestone albums of my career. And don't forget to pick up Converge's You Family Redux in stores June 17th.